Inquisitoris Frog from Salutum, and welcome back to our video podcast, Into the Darkness, where my friends and I play the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. Thomas Rayleigh, Nomen Meum Hospitis. Our scenario is Ghosts of Iron Mountain, and this is episode 3. It was written by Oscar Rios, and he's running it for us as our game master. We do suggest that you refrain from listening to this scenario if at some point in the future you want to play it as a character. It's all spoilers. We're using 7th edition Cthulhu Invictus rules, which are due to come out this year from Golden Goblin Press. Our recap will be given by Mick Swan. So sit back and enjoy the continuance of our tale. The players are ready. Let's begin our journey into the darkness. Mick.
Ex commentarius de Lucius Septimius Maro, Medicus Vulnerarius, Legione Septima, Hispania. Despite their straitened circumstances and the impending threat of ruin, or perhaps because of it, the good townsfolk of Eldora have shown us great hospitality, especially our host Amador. We rose early and broke our fast with wine and modest fare, while the soothsayer, Alicus, related the results of his recent augury, which indicated that some ill omen or natural disaster faces us. In the face of this shocking revelation, it was agreed that we visit the local temple and make offerings to the gods to secure their favor and goodwill. On leaving our lodgings, we encountered the priest of the Temple of Apollo and three youngsters who presented the prefect with a laurel of flowers and bestowed upon us Apollo's blessing of the dawn. From here, we ventured to the home of Decurius Luro. We were greeted warmly, and he willingly showed us his black steel spearpoint, a treasured heirloom, but resolutely refuses to part with it under any circumstances. He tells us of Evocati Titus Marcus Lurio, a veteran of the campaign against the inhabitants of Iron Mountain. The spear allegedly pierced the breastplate of a soldier in front of him, through his back, through Marcus Lurio's shield, breaking his arm, yet he carried on fighting. There is some disagreement between Lurio and the prefect Amateus, the former growing increasingly offended and the latter becoming visibly frustrated with Lurio's intransigence. The prefect leaves, and Volpi attempts to smooth matters over with our host, who elects to demonstrate the extraordinary properties of the weapon. We take our leave of citizen Lurio and go to the temple to make our propitiations to the gods before leaving for the mountain. Castus and Cordo are packed and ready to leave, and having checked and secured our donkeys, we head off up the mountain towards the home of the old hermit Jacomi. The trail is not too challenging, but its many dead ends and boulders, blind spots, present a clear tactical nightmare. Before too long, we arrive at the hermit's hovel. The hermit was hospitable, but told worrying tales of ghosts of fallen warriors who haunt the mountain, along with a white witch with whom he has had a number of encounters. This witch has, he said, lured a local shepherd named Estevo, who is said to be enamored with her. Furthermore, he tells of encounters with the skull-faced creatures who have stolen his goats and provides us with a rough map indicating where he's seen them. Old Jacomi speaks of whispers and strange dreams, indications that some evil stalks the mountainside, which fair puts the Phaeax up the rest of us. Despite his warnings, we have to press on regardless, it being our mission and our sworn duty. As we set off, Legionnaire Pullus spots a glint of movement way above us on the mountain. But of this we see no more. The mining camp turns out to be a little better appointed than we expected, with a rough bunkhouse offering some semblance of defensibility, albeit lacking in comfort. We eat a little supper and settle in for the night. Pallas and the drunkards, Caecilius, take turns on watch while the rest of us sleep. At first light, we set out to explore the mine. The first 60 yards or so are relatively modern, but as we press on, the tunnels become more primitive in aspect. Pullus thinks he hears a voice, and, concerned that we may have found a nest of brigands, we elect to set out in the direction from which the sound came. Crossing the boundary of the surveyed mine, we enter a tunnel in which Alicus is startled by a strange noise and a glimpse of a shadowy shape on the edge of his torchlight. There is the ominous clattering of Tommyknockers indicating the presence of danger, and we withdraw from that passage, saying prayers to the gods for our safety. Alacus casts the bones, one of which rolls into the darkness, and then, moments later, is cast back out of the shadows by some unseen force. Pullus and Alacus flee from the tunnel, followed by the foreman and the mining engineer. Unnerved that our auger and guides have fled, we retrack our steps carefully and follow them out of the mine. Volpe recounts the incident to the prefect, who has remained without the mine. While the mine seems structurally sound, the engineer maintains that the spectral occurrences render it unworkable, as no miners will work there. I don't think that any of us really wanted to go back in, but we steel ourselves and re-enter the mine, where Alacus hopes to entreat the ghosts to permit the mining to resume. Tempers are frayed and nerves are on edge as we cautiously thread our way back through the mine. Reaching a large chamber deep in the mine, we hear a familiar sound of blades being drawn. We follow suit, drawing our swords and readying ourselves for combat. Then the strangest thing. Everything goes black, pitch black, although we can still hear the hiss and crackle of our lit torches. From the darkness comes a whisper in broken Latin. Stop. Shh. Stop and leave. This is not your place. Slowly we withdraw from the mine again, and after some time we are once more able to see the light of our torches. This is magic. Dark magic. We are facing real evil here. May the gods have mercy on us. Et gloriam Deum Imperatorium.
Excellent. Oscar?
Okay, is this thing on? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Great. Okay, so it is now mid-afternoon. You've come out of the mines and informed the prefect of what had happened. The whatever enchantment had befallen your torches is no longer in effect. So you're standing in the mid-afternoon sun on Iron Mountain outside of the bunkhouse and the mine entrance.
I'm putting my armor back on because I've taken my armor off. I'm putting that back on.
Alacus, what do we do?
Pray.
Well, you're the auger. This is magic. What do we do?
Do another reading. Throw the bones. See what the bone gods say.
I can. I'm just... I think it's fairly clear. We need to... I don't want to say we need to leave, but...
I'll go back down there, but I'm not going back down there unless I have a good reading first.
Swords and whispers I can deal with. Darkness I can deal with. Magic.
I have a sword being drawn down there. Well, it makes me tell whoever's down there could be flesh and bone.
That was the voice of a human being. That was the voice of someone.
Let's see what the bones say. If the bones say no,
there are people down there, but there are people down there who are using magic. What happened to those torches? Wasn't natural.
Has any of you heeded my previous warnings to leaf offerings?
I was just about to throw some food in there, as what you're supposed to do with Tommyknockers.
Okay, if I roll, Oscar?
Go ahead.
45 out of 51, pass. But not a great pass.
The bones say that the... And it's odd because what they say really doesn't make a lot of sense. It says wait for the tide to turn. And you're like, well, we're in the fucking mountains. How does that help?
Mm-hmm.
But the bones will usually land in that position when change is about to happen. And your best action is to wait and have faith in the gods.
So I will share that with everybody and suggest that maybe we not rush down there right this moment, but spend the night perhaps and see what the gods will bring us in the morning.
I will agree with that. But at first I want to take a portion of whatever food we brought with us, a small portion, just a bite, and leave it inside the cave.
The miner and the foreman actually take one of, like, the, they decide that they're going to share their camp plate, and they put like a whole portion. They both take half of the dinner, of their portion of dinner, and leave a plate with like a full thing. They walk it 100 steps, counting these off, and then they leave it there.
All right. So mine is with theirs, and yeah. To thank.
So, and they say, if anybody else wants to add to this,
no.
Yeah, I'll add some of my portion to it.
And I had some of mine as well.
Okay. So you leave a goodly portion of some of your supplies, you know, for dinner. And these guys, you know, they cook. They're used to feeding large groups of people. I mean, and the soldiers can do that as well. So you enjoy a good dinner. You have provisions for 3 days. You're only on the second day. If you're here another night, it's going to be a very lean morning on the fourth day. So is there anything that you guys want to do as you're getting ready to, for the rest of the afternoon or and early evening?
I want to speak with the prefect.
I was just going to say the same thing.
Prefect, there are a number of things about this that bother me, that we hear the words spoken in our own tongue, that we hear the blades being drawn. It does not sound like a ghost. It sounds like there's somebody in there, and that we were getting too close to their, what they didn't want us to discover. I question whether the townsfolk are completely honest with us. Have they perhaps given all of their money to somebody who is now trying to drive them away in fear so that they can, there may be something in that mind that they want for themselves. This black steel is definitely an incredibly valuable substance.
As the man who looked over their books, I have to say that the paranoia is, I believe, unwarranted. But I was not down there. We have to assume that they're miners that wish to take control of the mine. They're people who know the wealth and have scared the others off, thinking that they can perhaps take the wealth for themselves. So here's what I suggest. As this magic, I wasn't down there, so it could just have been dark. It could have been a loose breeze. I don't know. We find this witch, this source of the superstitious magic. We bring her to the city, and we execute her. Now, as I said to you earlier, whether or not she is a witch doesn't matter. As long as the people believe that she is the witch, and that the spell is broken, they can return to the mine and continue working. But before they can do that, we must clear the mine of the people inside.
I am not so sure if it is permitted to disagree with you, if you'd like to know what I think.
I would love to know what you think.
I was also thinking of this white witch. But it may be that, you know, these sort of people, though they are dangerous, in the story of my own, you know, Greek, the stories of my people, the Stygian witches could be consulted for, they know everything. Of course, they also eat people, so you had to be incredibly careful in consulting with them, but I am more for finding her and consulting with her and seeing what she knows rather than executing her.
Something needs to be done to put the fears of the people at risk. Now, if we say the witch is dead, she's moved on, what then? they believe, oh, she's gone. We just need to find some way to make sure that the witch is no longer seen, no longer heard. Whether that be forcing her somewhere else or, as I mentioned earlier, killing her. But I'm not opposed to speaking to her first.
I'm still thinking, too, that this might be a hoax of some sort. And if we can bring that hoax to light, then we can tell the people, you were duped. These were not ghosts at all. These were just men in costumes who attacked you, and here they are. Have them executed.
Perhaps. But we know that the mine itself is filled with people. Yes?
I think so. I think so. The other thing is the Tommyknockers themselves. The Tommyknockers warn of disaster. They warn that there's an imminent collapse of the tunnels. That's what they traditionally warn. But there have been no collapses of any of the tunnels.
Perhaps tonight we block off the entrance to the mine. Just temporarily. So that way whoever's inside will be locked in there. They can't escape. They can't leave. The only food they have is what's on the plates that we provided them. Smoke them out.
That's what I was just going to say. You realize that a mine is a closed system. If we were to actually gather enough fuel, we could burn the entrance, and anything within it would be suffocated if it's alive. If it's ghosts, they're not going to be affected at all. But if there are people in there, they will be suffocated.
I kind of give this, you know, this smirk, and I nod and I say, it seems that two minds of a kind share good thoughts. And I turn to the group, and I kind of wave Fox over and I say, let's bring our idea to the rest of the group.
As you wish. Perfect.
So I approach the group and I say, gentlemen, Volpe and I have been discussing the mine and the people within. Now, it's obvious that from your description, they are people. What if, perchance, we literally smoke them out? We end the resistance within the mine and we find whatever the spell is and we break the spell, thus allowing the mine to continue operation because it needs to begin operating soon.
How do we break a spell?
We find the witch.
If there are living people within that mine, then they need to breathe. And if we light a bonfire in the entrance, it will soon consume all of the air.
So are you're thinking that whoever's casting the magic inside, once they die, their spell will be broken?
Yes. Well, their spell only lasted until we were almost out.
Yes.
I think that there's people in there, and we almost discovered their hiding place.
Can the engineer tell us how many air vents they put in?
They say that we put in sufficient air vents to bring in enough fresh air for about the first, you know, third where we were working.
Do you know where they are?
There's air and there's breezes. Yes, of course we do. We're the ones who
close them up.
Yeah, they say you do realize that if you do close up all the air vents, the fire will burn for a very short time.
Yeah, I would have said if we go to the air vents and just build small fires near the air vents as well to maximize the amount of smoke going through.
At which point one of the foreman says, this is all well and good, but you do realize I have three missing men that I don't know whether they're alive or dead. If there are people in the mine and they didn't simply attack you and kill you, it is possible that some of my missing miners are still alive down there.
But why are there people down there?
How long have they been missing?
They've been missing for about a week.
without food or water?
Well, if you're so convinced that there are people living down there, then apparently there's food and water.
Well, I don't know that they are living as we live. They may be hiding. They're in there temporarily, guarding something.
Well, we know if they're the same, if as we suspect they're the same people that attacked the caravan, then we know that.
He says, "We had our camp at the foot. We've camped here, living here for weeks at the, and no one ever got into the mine but us." You're assuming that a group of brigands are using the mine as a secret hideout. The mine was haunted by things, and it was empty. And when we were living out here without anyone coming or going.
Could there be another entrance?
If there is, our surveys didn't pick it up, and we've searched every corner of that mine.
What's on the other side of this mountain?
Well, you're in northern Spain, so very northern Spain, so it'd be almost the coast. A few, a few dozen miles, you'd be approaching the sea. So this whole region is mountainous.
The Costa del Monte.
But it's not like you can get to the top of the mountain, look down, and you'll see the beach. You know, it's a mountainous region.
Can I just point out, too, that none of them have actually attempted to harm us? And what you're suggesting could possibly be mass murder?
We need to assume that there is someone within the mine that doesn't want the mine to operate. We also know that if the mine does not operate, the people below will be forced out of their town, and the Empire will be forced to pick up what they've left off. That's a lose-lose for just about everyone. Now, we have several options of getting them out of there, at the mine. One of them includes smoking them out. The other includes sending our legionnaires, and I turn to the legionnaires, and sending them in to bring them out. And I don't think that they want that, and I don't want that either. So I'm open to suggestions, but I would rather smoke out possible brigands and deserters than my own men.
Considering what each of you has said, if there is, let us say, a wizard, someone with the abilities to use magic, I would make the one small assumption that he, at least, would know how to read. I can read and write. What if we create a declaration on a piece of parchment and put it down there for them to read, telling them that we're going to burn them out if they don't leave immediately, if they don't come out and surrender themselves. Then we could avoid murdering them.
Well, let's perhaps not be so very specific in our threats.
Good
if
idea.
We were to just say instead that if they don't negotiate with us, they will be forcing our hand.
Does that when you go in the entrance of the mine, does it go straight for a long way?
Not a long way. It starts to it branches off after about 60 yards, and it S turns and descends a bit.
Okay.
So if you look straight into the mines, it eventually would descend that you'd lose a straight line of sight after about 30 or 40 yards.
Okay.
So we put the letter down there.
Yeah, I'd like to put it back into the room that we were in when everything went dark, but
I would possibly be willing to accompany you.
I don't think that's a good idea. If there is danger, you should not be put into that kind of danger.
All right, well, it is night. Do you want to deliver this tonight? Do you want to wait until morning?
I say we do it tonight. We deliver it somewhere with near the cave entrance, and we wait until morning. If they don't leave by morning, we smoke them out in the morning.
I'll take it in. But we'll need to post guards so that if they do decide to come out, that we'll be there ready for them.
Hmm. All right. I turn to the lot of the group and I say, who'd like to stand guard?
Well, I think that...
I'd do it. That
falls on the three of us, doesn't it? Well, I think all three of us are in for a long night.
What happens if they can't read?
If they come out.
All right.
What
so
happens if they can't read?
Then we smoke them out.
Well, if they can't read, they won't come out.
You're going in with the letter by yourself as they stand guard?
Yeah. And what I'll do is I'll work my way far enough in, and I'll have this whatever I've written on with a rock, so that I can throw it the rest of the way down towards the area we were.
You get to where the plate was laid like an hour or two ago.
Mm-hmm.
And all of the food is gone.
Okay.
And
I'm saying prayers in Greek.
And a small stone is laid on its place.
Okay, I pick up the stone and look at it.
It's a tiny chip of a blue crystal.
Tiny chip of a blue crystal.
Do you have any kind of appraising skills?
Probably do. No, not a praise. I've got an art stuff, but no, my praise is only 5.
But it is not dirty, it is not dusty, it is polished and clear, and it shimmers in your torchlight. I mean, it's very small. It's really a
chip, yeah. But it's blue, like a sapphire. I get into position and I throw the rock, but then I'm quickly going to go back out and talk to them. So.
Okay. Okay, all right. You come out with this item.
So as I come out, I go, Prefect, this might be more than what we even imagined at this point.
Explain.
I do believe there are Tommyknockers involved. They have taken the food, and they left us this, and I hold out the crystal, and I'm like, this is not iron. This I do not know for sure, but it may be sapphire or diamond.
I pluck it from his hand, and I'm going to use appraise.
Do so.
4.
It is a very small chip of amethyst.
Ah.
And it's probably worth 250 sesterce.
Holy.
But as small as it is, you do notice it's been cut and faceted.
Well, gentlemen, I say that this is amethyst. It appears that our iron mine is not just an iron mine. It is a figurative gold mine.
A jewel mine, yes.
Well, yeah, we're looking at wealth beyond any reasonable expectation. This here is proof of the mine's worth.
The miners look at each other, and they said, we've never seen any signs of gemstones in any of our delvings or any of our test holes in this region.
Well,
they're like, we don't mean to be contrary, sir, but I don't believe that that came from here. From, you know, from what we've seen,
it was left on the plate by the Tommyknocker. I think that it's trying to tell us something. And I would agree with you. I would think that it's telling us that there's something far more valuable in there than steel. Although steel is still incredibly valuable.
But if indeed the occupants of the mine were men, could it not be payment for the food?
We paid them for telling us. Oh, I see what you're saying.
Could be them thanking us. We gave them offerings and they're
Is it perhaps an indication that they would be willing to parley with us?
Well.
Oh. Have you ever known that creatures that live deep within caverns often lose all pigmentation in their skin? They become white.
And the Myers do say that they've encountered white crickets deep in the earth while mining.
Our witch of Iron Mountain is white. And many, many years ago, the Carthaginians had great battles in this area. What if a tribe of Carthaginians, am I saying that right?
No, but that's okay.
Okay. Makes them Carthaginians. Sound like, makes them sound like heart disease. They moved, they established a colony within the caves, and that they live there in the mines, and they are where the witch came from. They are as white as snow. They are creatures of the darkness now.
They're ghosts.
Not ghosts, living creatures, but that they can't come out into the light. It hurts them.
What I'm saying is that they're white like ghosts. Could imply the legends of the hauntings of ghosts within the mines.
Maybe they don't mean us any harm at all. They simply are trying to protect themselves.
Well, this means something entirely new. It means that there are actually people within the mines that mined this. There are miners within there. They're just not our miners.
The old man Jacomi gave us a map showing us where to avoid the witch. It might be possible to use that to find the witch.
To find the witch?
Very easily so, yes.
If there are people,
it is past night, past sundown now.
Well, yes, and I did deliver the message, so let us keep a watch. But if they are a people, if they are a tribe, wouldn't it be better if we did business with them rather than?
That's exactly what I was thinking. Perhaps they can be reasoned with, and they themselves can mine from the mountain.
Or could be reincorporated into the village somehow.
Exactly. A deal can be made between the villagers and the tribe. And assimilation, if you will.
Okay, so do we want to skip ahead till morning?
Sure. Yep. Assuming I'll go to sleep or not,
we don't have to. Who is on morning watch?
I will have gotten up fairly early to watch.
I'll take the morning watch.
Okay, this is like half an hour pre-dawn, so it's way before you would be getting up. Lucius, I need you to roll a listen.
Oh, I got a 12.
You hear someone approaching the camp.
Who goes there?
And it says, a voice replies, "Oh, I mean you no harm. Please don't throw rocks.
Come forward. Show yourself."
It is a woman dressed in a tunic with a cloak, and she has a sack kind of on one shoulder and a one moment, I want to make sure of something. And a lamb on a string. She's kind of leading a lamb.
So this is a curious time for a woman to be out alone. Are you lost?
No, I'm looking for the people from the village. And are you one of the people from the village who are here in the mines?
Yes, we're here in the mines. Yes, we were sent.
As she comes closer, she says, "Oh, hello. I'm Zarina." And as she comes into your torchlight, or you know, as the pre-dawn lightens, you see that her skin is pale white, as is her hair, as are her eyes.
Please come sit by the fire.
Well, thank you. You're very kind. You're much kinder than the other people I've met from the village. And she sits down and says, "Is everyone else asleep?"
I believe so, yes.
Come in time. And she smiles and sits down and she says, "Oh, it was a long walk, but I'm glad that I made it in time."
What brings you here?
I've been sent.
By whom?
I've been sent by the Shadow Dwarves.
The Shadow Dwarves? You mean the dwellers
it's,
of the mine?
It's complicated. I should probably tell everyone at once. But yes, to speak with you on their behalf. I guess I'm an emissary. Is that the right word?
I believe so. Would you like to wait here by the fire, and I'll raise the others?
Most certainly. I've brought some. She says I have a skin of fresh milk. It's been in a spring, so it still should be cold. And this one is an extra, and I'm bringing it as a gift for all of us to share.
That's very kind.
She points to the lamb.
That's very kind of you. I should just wake my companions. And I shall immediately go and do that.
Has something happened?
It appears that your note has been answered. We must go without at once. An emissary has arrived.
I put on my best tunic.
Let's speak with this ambassador.
And legionaries restraint.
As you come out, you see that it is you find a young woman, probably 20. Well, I guess 20 wouldn't be that young. A woman of 20, with white hair, dressed in wool. And a woolen cloak with a nice pair of dark leather boots. And she has a lamb and a large skin slung across her back. And her hair is in a ponytail that starts kind of at the top side of her hair and drapes down, you know, across her shoulder and down her back. And as she's sitting waiting, she's bobbing her head left and right, humming to herself as if to some music none of you can hear.
Does the tune sound familiar? Is she humming?
Make a luck roll.
And that is a 20, so yes.
It does sound, you've heard it before.
Okay.
It's not unfamiliar to Gaius. Gaius, morning, I need you to make a sanity check.
Of course.
You had to ask, didn't you?
You had to go there.
And I make it.
Yeah. Okay. So you're like, oh boy, she's heard the same thing that I've heard, or maybe she's hearing it now. You're not sure. So you come out and you say, what?
I'll ask her, what is that tune that you're humming?
Oh, it's just a song. You hear it in the mountains.
Indeed. I heard it in my dreams the other night. Strange.
Oh, you dream. I dream too. And she says, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Thanks for not throwing rocks.
And I quietly sort of say to the prefect, I say, take great care, witches eat people.
She does not appear to be a witch by any standard. I approach and give a bow, and I say, I am Prefect Para. We here are emissaries from the north, come to make sure that the mine is working within the next few weeks. And who are you?
Oh, I'm Zarina. I am a shepherdess who lives in these mountains. And I've come to speak with you on behalf of the Shadow Dwarves and their Lord and Master, Gramagusina. Gramagusano.
I chuckle because it sounds all entirely made up. And I turn to...
Her brows knit.
I turn to Lucius, and I've got like this confused, like, where did you find this one? And then I turn back to her and I say, and what exactly is this message?
Oh, they want to know why you're trying to go back down into the mines.
Well, you see, the townsfolk, the villagers that you see just over here, I point to the foreman and the engineer, their town is currently under threat of eviction. They have no more money. Their crops are dying. Their people are leaving.
Yes, it's been dry for so long.
You see, this mine is their only source of income now. There's supposedly iron within the mountain, hence why it's called Iron Mountain, and that would be a great boon for the city, which means that the people would keep their homes. They wouldn't have to leave.
Okay, she says, well, that's very unfortunate for the people in the town, but the mine doesn't belong to the people in the town. The town belongs to the people in the town. The farms belong to the people of the town. The mine belongs to the Shadow Dwarves, and they're not inclined to share it.
These Shadow Dwarves, yes, that's what you call them?
That's what they call themselves.
Actually,
they have a longer name, but I can't pronounce it.
I beckon Marius Bevolpi forward, and I say, my friend here has a very curious thought that these people were once settlers that settled into the mountain itself. Is this true? Do you know?
I don't know how they got there. They were here when I got here.
Oh.
But you have converse with them. They trust you. They speak with you freely. How did you know?
In a way, I have never seen one. But there is a place that we use to trade things. And when I really need to speak with one of them, I sleep in that place. And in my dreams, I meet with their lord, Gramagusano.
Would they not perhaps be willing to trade with the people of the village?
So that both our peoples can prosper.
Well, that would be... I don't know. Would one of you be willing to speak with Garma Gusina? Or yes. All of you? I believe that that would be the most direct way to start a negotiation. If you wish to have words with them, then we must go to my place of trade, and you must sleep there. And your dreams should link up with that of the great old worm of the mountain, for he is a lazy dreamer, like a cat in the sun.
A question.
I'm willing.
A question, fair lady. Are you, by chance, the witch of Iron Mountain, as they call it?
Oh, I'm not a witch. I suppose I could be one if I put my mind to it. My father tried to teach me magic. He said that we have a natural gift for it. I learned a few spells, but no, I'm not really a witch.
Where did you come from? Did you come from the village, or?
I had a mother and father once, but my mother died before I really knew her. My dad and I traveled around quite a bit. We could never really find anywhere to stay. He was even paler than myself. So we wandered quite a bit, and I don't know much past that. Someone hit him in the head with a rock, and he died. And I've been here with my sheep ever since.
Would you excuse me?
That was 30 winters ago.
Would you mind if me and... Wait, 30 winters. I look to Fox.
Yes, you don't look like you are more than 20 winters old.
She smiles and says, "Why, thank you."
You are extremely long-lived. Have you found a
fountain of youth? Well, now I'm old. She says, "I don't know. I don't know how old I was before I started counting. But I've been in this area for about 30 years. My dad and I wandered for some time before that. Mm. But this is more..." And she squints at you. And she says, "Why are we talking about me so much?" She says, "Is this really happening, or are we asleep now?"
"Oh, I believe that we are wide awake."
"Well, good. It does get confusing sometimes. Would anyone prefect. Like some?" She says, "I'm being very rude. I'm a guest in your camp. I have brought this young lamb as an offering. I have too many this year, and with so few rain, there's not enough grass. So I thought that perhaps we could have him for lunch as sort of a communal gathering. I don't usually speak with people. Not this many at once, anyway. Oh, and I have milk, sheep's milk, and I've had it a full day in the spring I use, so it's very cold."
Who among us is the best cook?
"Well, I probably am. I was a slave."
Before Fox begins cooking the lamb, that it probably is really very cute, and I probably don't want to kill it, but whatever, it's Rome. When in Rome, I pull Volpe to the side because I know he wanted to speak to me, and I say, "Are we taking?" And I guess I pull the majority of the group aside, and I say, "Are we taking this seriously?"
"Well, the young woman has come here under truce as an emissary of the," she says, "the Shadow Dwarves. I mean, from a constitutional standpoint, we are kind of honor bound to listen to her."
"We only know what she tells us. And she may only know what she thinks she knows. The truth, that's harder to come by, but we can only come by it if we investigate. So
Well, she says that she's been here for some time and she has traded with these shadow dwarves, as they call themselves.
I find myself quite intrigued.
If she can trade with them, if they're willing to trade food for amethyst, then perhaps that could save the villagers. Perhaps the villagers could simply open up trade with them. If thing in the long run, trading with them would probably work out as profitable as mining. As long as the villagers,
I'd be very open to that, but I will also point this out, that this woman who says that she can't be any older than 40, but looks 20, says that we're going to be speaking with the Shadow Dwarves' leader, who happens to be a giant lazy worm that lives within the mountain.
Possible, figuratively speaking, who knows?
Yes, that could just be his title.
Nope. Yeah, we'll see how that works out for you.
Jim, don't give things away by shaking your head and telling us. We're role playing here.
Yeah, we're role playing.
Well, I'll get my toga and we'll all be LARPing in a minute.
Yeah, man.
I thought about it.
I've done it before.
I'm very curious to speak with whoever she is talking about. The prospect of opening up trade with a people who live within the mine. I mean, it might actually be far more lucrative than we can even imagine, especially if they've got access to jewels in the mountain.
Well, I'll tell you now, if they have the capacity to fight in the dark and to extinguish torches like that, you're going to need more than three soldiers to take them on.
Well, and it's my assumption that they can't come out here because of the light.
What do you think, Alicus? Don't tell me what the bones say. Tell me your gut feeling. We've been together for a long time now, and I appreciate your thoughts rather than the gods.
Yeah, I think she's shown no signs of aggression. They've treated us well, per se. I mean, I know there's been issues in the past with sabotage and such, and three soldiers have gone missing. But as far as us being here, we've been treated well. I would say we should be open to negotiations. And yet, at the same time, wouldn't hurt to put a rock in your pocket.
We also have one other thing. We did threaten them.
Yeah, I thought of that too.
And now she's shown up with food and milk, which it would be quite easy to poison so that their problem would be taken care of.
Well, the lamb is alive.
Yeah.
The milk I'm worried about more than the lamb. I'm not worried about the lamb.
But perhaps the food is a peace offering.
That's what it's supposed to look like, of course. But like I say, it would be so much easier to just kill us all, and then their problem would be solved because nobody would come back here.
Well, she's not privy to any of this because you guys moved off. So she's just kind of sitting.
But she seems quite innocent. Possibly she has knowledge of things that would benefit us greatly. I think that she might have a fountain of youth, if you will. She may be much older than we think.
Well, before we go with that, it's best to quench any paranoia that we have. So I nod to the group, I break off. I go to the woman. And I say, is it possible to have some of the milk that you offered?
Why, certainly, it's a gift. And she unsheathes this skin of sheep's milk.
And I guess I take a hefty drink. If I'm going to die, I'm going to die drinking milk.
It is sweet sheep's milk, and it is surprisingly cold. remember it is a hot summer day now. So it is not a bad as a peace offering gift, it's not bad.
I look at her and I say, is this 2%? Because I can't.
She says, what?
I turn to the group and I show them that I drank it and I'm not dead. So I guess they're fine with us.
Yes, but you might be farty the rest of the day.
That's okay. True.
So she takes out a length of rope. Well, she unropes the goat, the sheep's leash, ties both of its rear legs together, and hoists it up, and pulls out a black steel dagger with a leather wrapped hilt with blue gemstone crusts on it, and slits the goat's throat, whispering an apology in the sheep's throat, mm-hmm. the lamb's throat, whispering an apology to it as it bleeds out.
Hey, let me assist with that. Prefect, notice the knife.
I notice. Can I do an appraise just by looking at it?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay. Yeah. I'm going to do an appraise just by looking at it. Now, I got a 49 this time. Not as good as the 4.
But is it a successful?
It's a success.
If it is the black steel that you've seen in these mountains, that would be phenomenal. But it is an extremely well-made dagger. And if those are real gemstones, this could easily be worth 2,000 sesterce.
As I pass out on the ground.
And she cleans it and she resheaths it. She keeps it on her belt.
I think, Prefect, that it would be a very good thing if we could establish trade.
Perhaps that's a good idea. And I turn to the group and I say, perhaps that's the best idea.
She says, well, I trade small things with them. Cheese and milk and wool and flowers. Things they can't get.
What did you give them to give you that? And I point to the knife.
One of my extra lambs.
All right.
So they desire food and flowers, things that they don't have in the dark.
Right. And they'll give me things like tools. And I have this knife. And they'll give me stones now and again. They're pretty.
I think that it's vital that we speak with this Garm Gusano, is that what you said?
Garma Gusano. We can, I can take some of you, I can take all of you, we can go after we've eaten, or we can set this one to slow roast and come back and have some food. But they would definitely wish to speak with you. Well, Garma Gusano would want to speak with you. They're concerned.
Well, I'll tag along with whoever wants to go. I think you all should go.
I'll take the danger, yes.
Okay, so does everyone want to go with her? At this point, the mind foreman and the and the engineer will stay here looking over the slow roasting lamb.
Okay. Castus and Cordo.
So all of you are going?
Yes.
Yep. Sounds good.
Okay. All right. So you have a small breakfast of, with augmented by cold milk, and you have a lamb roasting as a peace offering. And she leads you. She says it's a bit of a walk, but we should get there by lunch and be back by dinner. Depending on how long your meeting is.
Okay.
So as you're walking, you can speak with her if you have any other questions. She is in surprisingly good shape. She's very agile and sure-footed on this terrain, as if she spends a lot of time here. And I need... Well, I'm not going to make it a roll. One thing that you notice about her as you're speaking with her in a peaceful fashion, she has earlobes that dangle almost a thumb's length.
Big, long earlobes. Does she wear any kind of jewelry?
No. No, she doesn't. The only thing that's really like outstanding is her boots and the knife on her belt.
Hmm.
Do not match the rest of her clothing whatsoever.
May I ask, Zarina, which gods do you follow?
She says, gods. I don't follow any of them. I live on the mountain.
I see. So there is none that you worship? No, no deity of any kind?
No. To what end, really? You live your life and then it's done. If there are gods, and yes, there are gods, but they do what they do and they don't really concern themselves too much, I don't think. I don't mean to offend if any of you have gods of your own.
Well, it's often been said exactly what you said, that the gods are the gods and it's best to just leave them alone. Their interference has caused a great deal of strife in human society. Do you know where you came from, you and your father, originally?
He says it was someplace called Gaul to the east.
Ah, yes, I know Gaul. So you're...
But beyond that, I do not know.
Well, that's pretty much the original, very early in the Roman Empire. France.
Yes.
They
we are from it. France. Just tell yeah, everyone.
From, you're a French girl. La la.
Okay, so is there anything else you wish to speak with her about? She knows a great deal.
This Garma Gusano, what is he like? You called him a worm.
Yes, he is the great worm of Iron Mountain. He's bigger than 10 whales and wiser than all the scholars in Greece and more powerful than every Roman legion combined. But he doesn't do much. He's as sleepy as an overfed cat in the sun. He is old and eternal like the mountain itself. But like the mountain, only rain can wash him away. Even giant worms hate water. But he lives deep in the earth, where it is dark and dry, and until recently, quiet. Which is why we're here today. Well, it's why I'm here today, to speak to you.
Is it the mining that has disturbed him and his people?
It has not disturbed him yet. It has made his people very nervous, and it has made his sleeping less sound. He hasn't woken up yet.
His people that's are why when we... that he might wait.
Yes.
They want him to stay
the
asleep.
Shadow dwarves are the children of Garma Gusano.
And he is, you say, you describe almost a god, somebody so huge.
Well, they worship him as a god. He's a worm. A big one. But a worm.
So you say that you dream a lot, and I kind of approach her, and I say, I had a dream on my first night arriving here. I was in the mountain, and someone with rough hands led me to the front.
The front of what?
The mine.
So you started dreaming in the mine.
I was asleep in my bed, and then I was there in the mine, deep in the mine.
What were you thinking when you went to sleep?
I don't recall.
Oh, and that's kind of important. That's how we'll know whether it was a dream or it was a dream.
What do you mean if it was a dream or a dream?
Well, sometimes I dream of things I know that aren't real. And sometimes I dream of things that are actually happening. Well, and then sometimes things are actually happening and it's not a dream at all. Like now, where this is really happening, yes?
Yes. You're saying that this here could be a dream or is a dream? Or
well, when you dream a lot, it becomes confusing as to what's real and what's a dream.
We think that it's real. It feels real. It doesn't feel like sleep.
Okay. Eventually get to an area that is a lot greener.
Okay.
So it's a little kind of valley area. And she says, this isn't far from where I am. And she says, you can just see my herds. And you see, like, in the distance, a flock of sheep that are kind of penned in by a stone wall. Okay. And she says, the spring is in this cave. And she strips off her boots before she enters. And she says, please no shoes in here. We don't want to foul the water in case you slip in.
Take off my sandals.
Right, yep. Take off my shoes.
Okay. You descend a very steep entrance, and you are in a very cool, dark cave. There's plenty of sun filtering in, so it's not like pitch black. But you see water dribbling out of a wall and catching into a large basin on the floor. So, and there's like buckets here. So this is where she draws her water from.
It's a natural basin in the floor.
Yes, it's a natural basin. And the water is, and she says, you can have some if you wish. And there's like a bucket and a ladle. It's very cold. And one second. And right on in one side, opposite the stream, the little spring, is a large flat stone table covered with runes. And she says, this is where I leave my things. And then I come back a day later, and sometimes there's other things there.
Hmm.
They usually tell me what they need in dreams.
Should we leave an offering of some sort?
Well, no, you're here to talk. You should try and sleep here.
Well, it's kind of early in the day, but maybe a nap?
Well, you'll need to sleep deeply. So get comfortable.
All right.
I guess we should lie down and go to sleep.
Is that the right move?
Perhaps a lullaby?
Okay, hold on.
Perhaps somebody should keep watch.
I was going to say the same thing.
I'll keep watch.
Okay, those trying to sleep, make a POW check.
I got a 15.
Oh, I failed. I got a 75.
You just have a nice nap in a nice cool, humid, damp cave. It's very refreshing, but you won't be part of this parlay.
Got a 50.
Those who fail or those who succeed?
If you fail, you will not. You will not make it into this meeting. So you just sleep.
I'm just having a nap.
Yeah. So
I got 54 out of 65.
So you're fine.
I passed by one.
You're fine.
I got a 10, so I'm there. I'm 100%.
Okay. I failed, so I'm asleep.
Okay, so the two soldiers just
all the soldiers are gone.
And sleep the dreamless sleep of an exhausted legionnaire. You're like, oh, we can sleep. You put your helmet down and you're like asleep in 5 minutes. It's like you've trained your body that when you can sleep, just sleep. You don't even dream.
I've just come straight off watch, so that's only to be expected.
You don't have to tell us twice.
Okay. All right. So the three of you, you're sleeping. And then you suddenly come awake. And you are no longer in the cave, the little cave spring. But you're in a much darker cavern that the walls and the ceiling are sprinkled with patches of glowing blue moss. And there are like little motes of white light floating in the air. And it's just massive, massive cavern. You can't even see the roof of it. And before you, sprawled out, kind of half below you, you're a little bit raised up on a stone platform, is this immense, massive, slime-covered tentacle worm. And when she said it is larger than 10 whales, she was not kidding. It is larger than 10 whales. It is by far the most immense creature you've ever seen.
This is a mountain god. This is one of the gods of the mountain.
I need all of you to make a sanity check.
I got a 70. I barely passed.
I got a 12.
Okay.
I'm expecting to see something spectacular.
You were not disappointed.
Terrifying.
I also passed, but I don't feel like I should.
I probably say some prayers in Greek.
You take 2 points of sanity loss even making it.
All right.
And you see the thing, like, its head is actually a mass of maybe a dozen even larger tentacles. These twitch, and the head just kind of like turns ever so slightly, ever so slowly. And almost like, it doesn't have any eyes, but you can see that it kind of turns and fixates on you. And you hear a voice very deep in all of your minds. Is this really happening? Are we dreaming? Are you here dreaming with me?
Yes.
Yes, my lord.
I must be.
Well, what do you want of me?
I approach the edge. There's the edge of the raised platform, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I say, oh, name I can't pronounce.
Garma Gusano.
Oh, Garma Gusano. We are the Romans who have been at the entrance of your mine for some time. We have encountered your people within the mines. I am named Para. This is Volpe. And this here is Alicus Sar. We are here
You've not said why you've come.
We're here to possibly negotiate trade with villagers that are on the edge of your mountain.
With your children.
Oh. My children don't play well with others. They've fled from others to my protection. I do not believe they would wish to trade with the humans who live at the foot of my mountain.
What of you, though? Would you like to trade?
I like to sleep.
Well, if you... If it's possible to trade with your children, perhaps you could sleep further, because there would be less interruption.
If the humans would stop digging into the earth on Iron Mountain, my sleep would be undisturbed. Why have you come? The humans farm.
Humans, the humans off your mountain farm, farmed, past tense, yes. And I'm visibly shaken because I'm talking to a giant worm. And I say, however, these farmers, they no longer can farm. All of the water has left their land. They are going to have to leave their homes if they don't have some sort of means of making something.
Can they not dig wells?
They've tried digging wells. Apparently that has not worked.
Why?
They cannot find the water that they need for their crops. Is there something that you can do, O great Aurea of the mountain?
I can instruct my children to divert water back under the humans so that their wells could support their crops. But that will take time. Have you no sorcerers to summon rain? Have humans lost those abilities?
Such magic is not known to us any longer.
Well, things forgotten can be relearned.
Teach me.
I turn to Volpe and I hold up my hands and I say, how long would it take to divert the water back to the villagers, and why have your children diverted the water?
They have diverted no water. There was never much water underneath where the humans lived. I would be directing more water under there. The ways of the earth, the deep earth, are known to us. Many things are within our capabilities. It would take a month, possibly two. But there would be enough water underneath the village to irrigate their crops.
This could be doable, but the people...
But there will be no further incursions into the deep earth. The humans farm. They will not mine here.
If it's possible to have their crops irrigated, then no mining will occur on Iron Mountain, my great worm ship.
The Shadow Dwarves, my children, the Ordentani, say that the Romans do not keep their word. I will tell you this. If I agree to direct my children on your behalf, and one more human disturbs my sleep by entering the deep earth, I will wake up. And then I will need to get comfortable again before I can sleep. And the last time that happened, an army was destroyed.
How long ago was this?
Oh, I don't know. Several centuries.
I think that it's completely...
Shortly before the Ordentani came to me for protection.
I think that this is completely reasonable. Now, the town does need to stay afloat in the time for them to grow the crops. To avoid complications with your mine, is there perhaps a trade that the three of us can work with you and your people so that we can provide an immediate means of currency?
I do not wish to deal directly with the humans below the mountain, neither do my children. We will choose a third party emissary as a go-between. Speak to Zarina, the child of Hyperborea. We trust her.
The child of Hyperborea? I don't know where that is. She said she was from Gaul.
Humans have forgotten so much.
I know, my lord, where Hyperborea is.
Do you?
Yes.
Okay. You have a cult?
Well, I'm Greek. The whole Hyperborea mythology came from the Greeks originally.
Okay. He says, if you wish further, more direct assistance for the humans, you will need to deal with Zarina, and she will convey messages, and we'll see what we can do. But again, this is all the allowances I will make. I've directed my children to be restrained, but they have long memories of Rome.
I think you this are, is... Oh, go ahead, Volpe.
I was just going to say, you are very gracious to allow this.
Talk with Zarina. See what can be done. She will convey your replies.
May I ask but, one more question?
Well, you're here, so I suppose there's no harm.
What happened to the miners that were taken? Are they dead, or are they with your children?
I can ask.
If you could ask, that would be very gracious.
Okay. It kind of wiggles one of its tentacles, and you see a trio of figures suddenly standing kind of behind you, and they come up.
Are they the miners?
You'll need to make another sand check.
Ordentani?
Yes.
Okay. What do they look like? 65 pass.
I passed too.
I got a 91.
Okay, I don't know how the worm didn't bug you out, but these guys do. No loss if you make it, and you lose 2 points. Start okay, keeping so track if you've lost enough in a game hour.
Right. No, I just jumped.
Okay. They are about 5 foot tall, broad-shouldered. They're wearing, one of them wears black leather and has a shaved head. The others are wearing black chainmail and carrying swords, and they're almost like an honor guard for this central figure. And he bows, and they have a conversation psychically that you're not privy to. And the dream figures look over at you and just like begrudgingly nod. But they look like gray-skinned humans with large eyes and you know, thick, shaggy hair and broader build. But like mm-hmm. their eyes are just, there's no pupil to them. There's just these large, white, pupil-less orbs in their head. And he says that, okay, I need you to roll a luck.
Which one? Which one of us?
You're the one who asked, so I'm going to have you roll the luck.
Fun. What's my luck? Luck's a 50. 33. Awesome.
Okay. Is that a hard success?
33. No. 25 would be a hard.
Okay. Unless you burn luck, the miners are dead. If you burn luck for a hard success, I will allow one of them to still be alive.
One? I mean,
well, there's
one,
four missing.
One is better than none, as I always say.
That's true.
Yeah, why not?
You can't push a luck roll.
Nah, man. I got it. I'll do, so a 33, 25, so it would be, I'd take 8. Okay, that's not that bad.
Okay. Right,
down to 42. I'm good.
I say one of them is still alive. And as a sign of good faith, when we reach a formal agreement, I will order them to release him.
Excellent. With the release of him and with the irrigation of the crops, the people there will no longer mine in the mine. We will tell the people that the mine is haunted by spirits. They are to not go there, but that we have found a solution to their irrigation problems.
They must believe you, Prefect. Because if they do not, they will return here. And once the terms are violated, you know the penalty.
They will not.
I do not wish to destroy their little town, but I will to protect my children and ensure my rest.
Well,
we will tell them that the God of the Mountain has spoken.
Go now, humans. Go in peace, and I hope never to encounter your type again. No offense. You seem reasonable sorts, but this is quite taxing.
No problem. I get it.
And then the three of you wake up.
Cool.
And the two legionaries are soundly asleep.
I look to Gaius, because Gaius is still awake, and I explain everything.
Okay, hold on. While Gaius, you were on watch, did you wish to speak to Zarina or do anything? You're here like 2 hours.
Yeah, all I was going to do is try to flirt with her, but and while the other
she actually is very flattered, and she says that she has her eye on someone in the village, a young boy, who is interested in her.
That's terrible.
And she says that it would break his heart if I was to spend time with you. And nice. I sense in you an unserious mind, and you would not be here for when a possible child arrived.
Ah. What do you mean if, probably not.
She says when my child would need a father, and I believe Estevo would make a good one, and you would be gone, and Estevo would be mad. And if not to have a baby, why else?
Why else? Hey, you're asleep.
Okay. But she thanks you.
I'll also ask her more about her ways and her,
She lives here by herself. She'd like to go into town to trade. But every time she approaches someone, they throw rocks at her. And in conversation, it turns up that she only ever tries to talk to two or three people. Mm-hmm. And one of them is the grumpy old man who always throws rocks at her. And the other is Estevo, who has been flirting with her for a few weeks.
Yeah, I think that he thinks that you might have whisked him away and probably sacrificed him or eaten him or something like that.
No, he goes home to his family.
Yeah, well.
And the other humans up here, they seem a dangerous sort. I haven't tried to talk to them.
Tell me about these other humans. Are they the ones that wear the mask?
Yes. People think that they're ghosts, but they're not real. I mean, they are real, but they're not really ghosts. It's kind of disappointing.
Do you know where they come from?
They have a camp. It's beyond the high pastures.
What I mean is, were they always here, or did they show up?
No, they came. They came after they took the first ore off the mountain.
Hmm.
But yeah, I wouldn't want to speak with them.
But you said you know where their camp might be.
Oh, I know where their camp is.
You know how many of them there are?
I could find out.
Yeah, because we might be able to, excuse me, we might be able to deal with that problem.
Okay. I can show you on a map and maybe I can find them in a dream and find and count them.
Okay.
But what would you do for me? There's things that I need.
What would you need?
Oh, there's plenty I need. What could you get me? She says that I could use a couple of dark rams to augment my herd.
The dark rams?
Black wool.
Oh, well, I'm a soldier. I'm not a farmer or herdsman.
I would try and trade with the village myself, but they won't let me in.
Well, what if we can take care of this problem with these men? And when we go back to the village, we bring you with us, and we'll protect you, and we'll try to, you know, settle things between you and the villagers.
Let them. I would like that. I would like that very much. I would like to be able to trade. I have plenty of a few things and none of others.
Okay. Well, I'll try to, you know, do something like that for you.
Okay. So we'll say the rest of the group wakes up after you've been speaking to Zarina. And again, she's very flighty. And she may be a little crazy, but you find her to be kind of harmless. Okay. And, you know, there's a logic to her thinking in a disconnected childlike sort of way.
She's just been out here by herself too long, basically.
Yeah, pretty much.
So we've woken up and we're in the cave still, yes?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think, Prefect, our course is clear now, isn't it?
Yes. We tell the people of the village that the mine is haunted and that the road is too dangerous because of bandits. But the main thing is that it's haunted and that the god of the mountain says that they are not to return, but we have solved the irrigation problem and their crops should return now. The drought is over.
And that... That Zarina will be the emissary between the god of the mountain and the shadow dwarves and the people of the village.
I look to the group and I say, maybe we don't go that far. I think that we simply instill the fear within them, and then that's it. They don't come back to the mountain.
Well, curiosity could, you know, distill that fear.
So can torches and swords.
Yeah. However, if we do bring her back to the village as an emissary, that might work. They fear her more. If we were to say, don't go up into the mountains, you know, and the drought is over, that might work for a few months, maybe a couple of years. But afterwards, they'll say, I'll go back up to the mountains and do this all over again.
Her appearance is unusual, but we shall simply tell the people that she is from Hyperborea, which is to the far, far, far north, to the ice and snow, and the white is the color of the people that live there.
What if we...
Says I've heard that name before. Well, I think my father mentioned it once or twice.
Yeah, the word literally means beyond the north. Of Hyperborea.
Zarina, what would happen if we blocked access to the mine? Would that disturb the god of the mountain further, or by blocking the entrance to the mine, would we solve the problem?
I don't know. Should have asked him.
Well, we should block it and hide it. Camouflage it so that...
But, she says, I'd be happy to go with you to the village. So how have you solved the drought? It isn't raining.
In about a month or so, the ground will become soft so that the crops will grow.
Well, no, they'll have to build, have to dig wells.
The wells will fill with water.
They'll
fill with water.
We'll be able to produce, They'll need to dig new wells, but the wells they already have will be able to draw more water.
The gods will.
So they'll need to build some kind of a pumping irrigation system. But with Roman engineering, that's not out of the realm of possibility at all.
All right.
Archimedes. So, gentlemen, shall we head back down to the village and tell them the good news?
I think it's good news.
Yeah.
Okay, do you go with her?
Yes.
And you take her with you?
Are we going to take her with us?
Yes, legionnaires, be prepared to push people away from her, because there will probably be people jeering and stuff like that. People who are afraid.
Okay, you spend another day on the mountain, just because, you know, you kind of get back to your camp.
Right.
And she says that she can't be more away than more than two days, because she's got to get back to her herds. What?
Yeah, we do eventually wake the soldiers up and bring them.
Right. You do wake the soldiers. When I said everyone was awake, I meant them.
Fight you.
No more goat soup. All right, so you get back to camp, and the lamb is delicious. You head down the mountain the next day with Zarina, also known as the White Witch of Iron Mountain. And as you're coming up, everyone's like coming out to meet you, and then they see that you're with this pale woman, and you're expecting them to like start grabbing rocks. A few of them, like, you know, have farm implements that they're carrying nervously, but they generally follow you and they're not menacing, but everybody's like, hey, you're back. And they kind of see her and they're like, okay. And they start following the procession as you head to the center of Eldora. So by the time you get there, word has traveled and the Council of Elders is already setting up the meeting hall in the old mercantile exchange to have another, you know, meeting with all of you. And they see that, you know, you've brought the, you know, this woman, and they were like, so the guy who you, the main guy, hold on.
Alice Gradius Verus.
Right. He's, you know, greetings. You've been gone a few days, but it's wonderful to see everyone back. And you've brought a guest, prisoner? Yes. Are you... and it says, he says, okay. Welcome to Eldora, and you are? And she goes, oh, I'm Zarina. And like, okay, shall we sit? And they look to the prefect, like, what's going on here?
You should sit. I will stand, and I suppose that I will explain.
Okay, so he ushers everyone into the warehouse building that's now like, and then closes the door so that the bulk of the villagers who are wondering what's going on won't be privy to this meeting.
I say
so. It's basically you, the Council of Elders, and Zarina.
I say, elders. Let me first start by saying that we have been to the mine, and we have deemed the mine unusable. Not only is there the possibility of sabotage, bandit attacks, and so forth, but it seems that your superstitions are correct. The mountain is cursed, the mountain is haunted, and the god of the mountain is displeased with the mine's attempts at boring deeper within it.
So we are doomed then?
This is not so. We have found a solution to your drought.
They lean forward like, what?
We have gone to the mountain and we have offered tribute to the god of the mountain, and by Jupiter, he has allowed the drought to end. You will simply need to dig new wells and get started. It should take about, as my device goes off, no, don't question what that was, a council of elders. You'll simply need to dig new wells, and then within a month or two, the wells will start producing water. Enough water to irrigate your land.
They
but on one
look,
condition.
They look... Okay, go ahead.
Do not enter the mine and do not dig on Iron Mountain. The mountain is now a sacred place. It is cursed. It is haunted. It is sacred.
Okay. Make a persuade.
All right. Make a persuade check. I can do that. All right. Where's my persuade? 55. All right. What do I get? What do I got? A 27. All right.
Okay. Well, we understand that the mountain is sacred and haunted, and that the gods of the mountain do not wish us there. Since we've gone to into the mount, back into the mountains, nothing good has come of it. So we will abide that by that decision. But first of all, if what you say is true, and we don't call you a liar, sir, but if what you say is true, then we will have water to replant in 2 months. And we must dig new wells and set up pumps and that such. Correct. So we're to switch back to our farms.
Yes, and I will be speaking with the governor and the magistrates to assist you with whatever they can so that they can get your city back up and running.
They say we've already asked for loans and extensions. They will not extend any further credit to us. And they said, and what you're asking, sir, we would need to replant. We would need to rehire farm workers. We'd need to pay for wells to be dug and pumps to be built. And even if we could do all of that, it would take a year or possibly more before we could bring in a first crop. We don't have that much time. What will we live on for the next year to switch back to farming?
And this is where I turn to Zarina. I can't believe I'm going to do this. This is where our friend Zarina comes in. Think of Zarina as an emissary to this god of the mountain. The god of the mountain who is providing you with the water. If the god can provide you with the water necessary to grow your crops, imagine the things that he can provide you for simple menial things. And I turn to Zarina and I say, can you show them your knife?
Oh, I'd rather not. But if... Is it money that you need to replant and rehire and do all of these big things that you need to do to get your farms back up and running?
It is what they need, yes.
And she turns to the Council of Elders. Then we don't need to bother Garma Gusina with that. You can trade with me.
It's why she's here. She desires trade with you.
And they were saying, well, what was it that you wish? What is it you wish to trade? And she says, well, it's I have a list of demands. And she smiles and pulls out a goat skin that she's written up a list of. And hold on. She says, okay, I want to be able to come into town whenever I want to trade and no one is to throw rocks at me or tell me I can't come in. And they kind of nod like, okay. Oh, I'd like some help building a proper stone house. So if some people could come up and help me, that would be great. Eyes for my wool, a new loom, a larger spinning wheel, some chickens, a nice Vural black ram. I really want a sheepdog. I noticed some of the villagers have one. I'd love one. And I want Estevo to come and spend 3 days a month with me. What? And they were like, Estevo, the boy from house. She says, yes.
Well, I don't think that we can, you know, force Estevo to come and stay with you for 3 days, but I'm sure that we can speak with
him. I want you to force him to only spend 3 days with me. He wants to spend all his time with me. But I only want him there 3 days a month. He can live in the village other than that.
Well, I think that this is something that's not directed towards the elders. It's more directed toward Estevo and his family. So,
and they were saying, well, all of this is well and good, but I mean, what have you to offer us in return? You said we would trade with you. What you're asking is within a reason, but they said you don't understand. It's not.
What do we get in return?
Right. Oh, and she comes forward and pulls out a bag and dumps it out. And there's literally a king's fortune in amethyst, opal, and sapphire chips.
Gentlemen, I think we have found the solution to your problems.
She says, so I can let you have this. Well, and she takes half of it. She says, I can let you have this now. And when you do all of those things, I'll give you the other half. And is this going to be enough money to do all those big things that you need to do?
Can I?
You roll.
Oh, I was going to say, can I do an accounting?
Yes.
All right. Let's do an accounting. 36 out of 60, so not a hard bet.
This would, the half of the gems that she put out, this is more than enough to pay all of their debts and to reestablish everything they need to do. So basically, she's given them the money to switch their economy back over to agriculture and to support the town for the next 9 months.
Well, there you go. I look at her and I say, this alone is more than enough to pay for everything, but I think that the elders would be wise to listen to a prefectus Ayari when I say that you want to trade with her.
She says, wait. You said it's more than enough. And she says, can I ask guys a question?
Yes.
And she rushes over to Gaius and whispers, should I ask for a couple of pigs too?
And I give her a look, and I look over my shoulder and give them a look, and I say, ask for four or three. Three or four.
And she smiles. And she says, I want three pigs. And one of those vials and one of those things filled with olive oil. And they're looking at the gems and they're like,
and don't forget the wine.
Okay. Oh, and one of those for wine and another one for my friend. Is that okay? Do you need more? Like, no, we're good. And she smiles and she's like, yeah. And she's like, thanks.
I really like this girl. I say, if things don't work out with the young man, you know.
And the elders say, Prefect, could you step outside with the emissary so that we can discuss this for a moment and then we'll summon you back in? This is a decision we all need to make.
I nod, but then I'm gonna take those gems off the table and scoop them into my pouch. Okay. I say, you think. And I walk away.
Okay. So she goes outside and there's a boy there and he's like, what are you doing here? And she's like, hi, Estevo. And she says, these men brought me. They said that it would be safe. And he's like, and he like goes over and kind of like hugs her. And she smiles and says, "Don't worry, it's all going to work out."
Are we still inside where the elders are?
No, they wanted the room cleared, so you're outside with her.
We're all together, and we're just going to wait.
Okay. They open the door, and they say, "Please come back in," and they said, "And summon several pages." You know, so we need some messengers.
Okay. Scribes.
And they say, "Yeah, we're going to write this up," and he starts writing this down. And he says, "It looks like Aldora has a new landlord." And they smile. They said, "Zarina, we will build your house. We will give you your livestock and any goods within reason you request, in return for you giving us the money to reestablish ourselves. If Estevo agrees," and then the elder that's actually in charge of his family, she yells, you know, he yells out, "And even if he doesn't, he'll spend 3 days with you of your choosing per month at your home on Iron Mountain, as long as you ensure that he will be well treated and safely returned at the end of those 3 days." And she said, "Only 3 days." And this is, "As you wish, only 3 days." And he's like, "What?"
Only
and
three.
She says, "After 3 days, a guest becomes a burden." It's every month. You can wait.
Like fish, then, they start to smell. Yeah.
I then say, "Now, also in accordance with Zarina and the mountain god's wishes, one of your miners will be returned, as we have negotiated it with the god."
Only one. They were like, "Wow, only..." Then the others are gone.
The others are unfortunately gone, but we negotiated the release of one.
"Well, thank you. You have saved Eldora, but what of the creatures in the mountains? Are these the people that we are dealing with? Are these the..."
"The children of gods are often strange. And the god of the mountain has children who live in the mountains, and he protects them. And to be perfectly frank, he threatens that if his mountain is disturbed, he will destroy everything."
"Well, we will not return to the mountain. We will abide by the mountain god's wishes."
There is one other small problem, and it's that there is a tribe of men that have moved onto the mountain, the ones who attacked your miners. Isn't that correct, Cassilius?
"Yes. And I pretty much, actually, since she's here, I'll have her
tell one me. Of the elders say, "These are not our people. And will they threaten this agreement if they remain up there?"
"I'm not so sure that the god of the mountain knows the difference between us and them. He calls us all just human. And if they're human and they break the rules, we need to find a solution to that."
"With wealth of this level, it would not be impossible to engage mercenaries to put down such a..."
"True.
A group. Or to drive them off at the very least."
And as Arena says, "I know where they are." Okay, so they can definitely hire a band, a company of mercenaries to go up and attack the camp where these people are while the wells are being dug. And have Zarina kind of show them where these people are, if that's your wish.
That would be wonderful.
Yeah.
Okay, so at this point, we may be done.
Okay.
Awesome.
Since you've decided not to go up into the mountains yourself to deal with these guys and let the town hire mercenaries and kind of put an X on the map where they are, that's still dealing with the bandits. You have saved Eldora, negotiated a loan with the Witch of Iron Mountain so that they can change back their economy. And you've convinced the council never to try and reopen the mine. So if you guys are fine with it, I'm going to call this a win in the end.
Hooray, none of us died.
Hooray.
Nice.
Is it a solution that some of the other players have
come up? You came really close a couple times. Had you guys pushed it in the mines any further than that, they would have attacked, and including causing a cave-in to trap you in the mine. But because you backed off twice, they started to kind of feel maybe you could be dealt with, negotiated with, spoken to, which is why they sent Zarina to try and, like, you know, maybe they're not idiots. You know, maybe we could actually deal with these people.
So it was,
but it was really, it was a very old Chthonian, a very old and powerful Chthonian living in Iron Mountain. And the sound of persistent mining was disturbing its sleep.
Lazy bastard.
Yes, he's the lazy worm, the lazy fat worm of Iron Mountain. The people that were defending him, as you guessed, were the descendants of the tribes that had resisted Roman encroachment.
Oh.
The tribes that went missing, they evolved very quickly under Gamer Gusina's magic into a race that could survive in the Dark Earth.
Was the poisoned lake anything at all?
How do you kill a Chthonian?
Oh, okay. Water.
Yeah.
And where is this lake located?
Right up on the mountain. Right above
Right above the mines. Had you decided to kill Karma Cassina, you could have hastily built an irrigation system to flood the mine with water. Zarina actually kind of hinted at that, saying that, like a mountain, the only thing that could harm him was water, because even giant worms hate water.
Right.
Yeah.
So she hinted that you could have drowned him out. If you start building an irrigation ditch from that lake into the mine, the dark dwarves will attack. And then you'll have a pitched battle on your hands. But for groups that do not want to deal, make a pact with a Chthonian, there's a way to take him out of the picture.
Hmm. Really a good scenario.
Yeah, I was on the edge.
A lot of fun.
Oh, I was on edge the entire time.
I want you guys to know, not only have you survived an adventure that TPK'd another group with one survivor, you did it without rolling a single combat.
Yeah. Wow. You're awesome.
Which is very rare. I run a lot of Call of Cthulhu. This is what I call a perfect game. There are groups that play Call of Cthulhu for 15 years and never get through an entire game without rolling combat. I believe you should be kind of able to, you know, if you play your cards right, get through a game without combat. And somehow, in a group full of soldiers, you negotiated and investigated your way through the entire scenario without rolling a single combat attack.
We are Roman. We are civilized.
So, dudes, congratulations and hats off. It is a rare feat for a group of Cthulhu investigators to succeed without violence. But this is one of those scenarios where if you understood the players, you could get to the end without violence. Or you could push your luck and everyone dies.
Oscar, thank you so much for running this game for us. It was
yeah, that was brilliant. Fun.
Thanks very much. Thank
you. I know that you've got a Kickstarter that ends
midnight tomorrow.
Well, let's give the date because this won't be processed until tomorrow.
Friday, March 31st, midnight Friday, March 31st. Cold warning ends.
So for those of you who are listening right now, that's tonight.
Right. So currently, it started as one scenario, which was Cold Warning, which is a scenario set in Arkham and in rural Maine, in a hunting lodge in rural Maine in winter, because you know that's not creepy. Now it has also become a second scenario called Riding the Northbound, which is a hobo odyssey, and the entire group are hobos, tramps, and bums traveling cross country right around Thanksgiving, so November in New England, a cold November in New England, to attend a party being held by one of their friends who just married a rich widow. Because, you know, hobos are lucky like that. and why would that be odd? We are $153 currently away from unlocking Riot at Red Plank, which is a scenario set in 1903 Copper Country in, I believe, Michigan. And everybody's playing Finnish immigrant copper miners who are trying to form a union.
That sounds cool.
So hopefully by the time this airs, that'll be unlocked and funded. Cool. And the final stretch goal after that is a haunting in Kingsport, where the group are a group of paranormal investigators and spiritualists investigating the most haunted house in Kingsport, the site of a New Year's Eve 1899 spree murder where the Pomeroys murdered all three of their children and their servants before killing themselves.
So there's still a little bit of time to get in on this Kickstarter if you're interested, and it's called
Cold Warning.
So go to Kickstarter and look for Cold Warning Oscar Rios and it'll come up, and Golden Goblin Press. You'll have a few hours left to contribute. All right, so our players included Thomas McKeon, Mick Swan, Simon Ward, Jeff Wilkins, Wayne Worthy, and myself, with Oscar Rios as the Keeper of the Secrets. Be sure to visit Golden Goblin Press for all the coolest supplements and scenarios for the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. Our musical intro, The Wisdom of Minerva, was written and performed by Michael Levy, and is from his album Ode to Ancient Rome. It's available from all major digital music stores, and a link to his website is in the description below. If you'd like to help us out on production and presentation costs, you can visit our Patreon site and contribute a few dollars. It'll be deeply appreciated. We currently are producing 4 shows a week with music and sound effects added in post-production in order to create a richer listener experience. We also provide audio-only versions of our shows free for you to download from Podbean or iTunes. Feel free to send us comments on the show. We'd love to hear from you. If you enjoyed our broadcast, please give us a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel for updates on our latest shows. You'll find links to everything that I mentioned in the description below. This is Tom Rayleigh inviting you to journey with us once again into the darkness for another adventure into the universe of H.P. Lovecraft and the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. Until next time, fortune bono lascivio venatus.